I want to scream it out from every mountain top. Your goodness knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. And I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. Yes, I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. Nothing and no one comes anywhere close to you. The earth and oceans deep only reflect this truth. And in my darkest night, you shine as bright as day. Your love amazes me. Sing it out. Yes, I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. And with a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim, you are good, you are good. In the sun or rain, my life celebrates. Lord, you are good. You are good. With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good. You are good. And in the sun or rain, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good. I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. Yes, I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. And with a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim, Lord, you are good. You are good. And in the sun or rain, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good. Yes, I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. Yes, I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. Yeah!
Amen. The Lord is good.
Amen.
We are in strange times with lots of battles. Amen. This next song reminds us that we are surrounded by Him.
There's a table that you prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles.
Sing that with us. There's a table.
There's a table that you prepared for me. Presence of my enemies. your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. And I believe you've overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for all you've done. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. In the valley, I know you're there with me. Surely, your goodness and your mercy follow me. So my weapons are praise and thanksgiving. This is how I fight my battles. And I believe you've overcome. And I will lift my song of praise for all you've done. This is how I fight my battles. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how, this is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. This is how. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
You, Lord.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how, this is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight. My victory's in Jesus' name. My victory's in Jesus' name. My victory's in Jesus' name. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. This is how. Look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Thank you, Lord.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me.
Thank you, Lord, for your life.
You have been so, so kind to me. Holy, overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights that I'm found, leads the night denied. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it.
Still your love fought for me.
You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless.
Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Snow wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Snow shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No. Snow wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I can't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Coming after me, no. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me, no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up, none you won't climb up, coming after me, no. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never.
Our goal in life is to love Jesus above all else.
passion in life is to know you. May all other goals bow down to this journey of loving you more. Jesus, you showered your goodness on me, given your gifts so freely. But there's one thing I'm longing for. Lord, hear my heart's cry and my prayer for this life. Above all else, captured by you. Jesus, you shall are my greatest treasure. Nothing this world can offer could ever compare to you. Lord, hear my heart's cry and my prayer for this life. Above all else, above all else, above all else, give me yourself. Jesus, my passion in life is to know you. May all other goals bow down to this journey of loving you more. Jesus, you've showered your goodness on me, given your gifts so freely. But there's one thing I'm longing for. Lord, hear my heart's cry and my prayer for this life. Above all else, above all else, above all else, give me yourself. And all who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy, as deep cries out to we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, tempted. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. Waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus, come. Come Lord Jesus, come, come Lord. Come Lord Jesus, come. Come Lord Jesus. Deep cries out to deep, as deep cries out to deep, we sing, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come, Lord, come, Lord. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord. Deep cries out to deep. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
The next song that we're going to sing is called Survivor. I have asked Andrea if she'd read some scripture for us. Listen closely from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning with verse 7.
But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal.
So long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stone on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace, but you showed and came, showed me the way. When I was a low soul, searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eyes so I could see. When the smoke was rising up, you were the air that I could breathe. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in. You pulled me out of the fire. Now I'm a survivor. Now all I can see are the fields of your grace. Wherever I run, you're leading the way. You shook the shackles off my feet. I found redemption on my knees. You gave me hope, gave me something to believe. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. Oh God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. Lord, your love came crashing in. You're my God. You're my fighter. You make me a survivor. You're my God. Oh, you're my fighter. You make me a survivor. You're my God. Oh, you're my fire. You make me, Lord, a survivor. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in. Pull me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Now I'm alive and born again. I'm rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in. Thank you, Lord. I'm out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Survivor. I'm a survivor.
God bless you.
We come to study a book that is indeed a treasure of mine and of every believer, really, the book of Ephesians. I'm excited about this because it's a book that I absolutely love. Now, just by way of introduction, I want us to look at the first two verses of the first chapter, and then we're going to talk a little bit around that thought. The Apostle Paul writes this, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so here, Paul, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he introduces us to this marvelous book. Now, years ago, the Los Angeles Times reported a story about a man and a wife who were in their 50s and they died. When they found him dead in their apartment, they did an autopsy, and what the autopsy revealed is that they had both died of malnutrition. What was interesting was that when the police found their bodies, they searched the apartment and they found in the closet sort of a whole pile of little bags. They opened the little paper bags and they found $40,000 in cash. Now think about how ridiculous it is to die of malnutrition and have 40 grand in paper bags in your closet. Now that's not really understanding how to use your resources. Now, how does that relate? Well, the book of Ephesians is written to Christians like those people. You say, well, what do you mean? What kind of Christians are that? Well, the kind of Christians who don't understand the riches that they have in Christ. The kind of Christian who sort of wanders around through life with a case of spiritual malnutrition, who doesn't know where the feast is. The kind of Christian who doesn't know how to tap into his resources, maybe because he doesn't know what they are, and so he never really has found out how rich he or she is. So if you get a handle on the book of Ephesians, it's going to completely change the way that you live here and now. In fact, some people have called the book of Ephesians the bank of the believer. And that really is the book of Ephesians. It's a book about riches. It's a book about fullness. It's a book about being filled with things. It's a book about inheritance. It's a book that tells us what we own in Jesus Christ. So you're going to want to get the book of Ephesians down. You're going to want to get it down good. Because if you do, it'll absolutely revolutionize the way that you live your life. In fact, I think that we're going to have sort of a re-revolution of Bear Creek by the time that we get finished with this book, because it's filled with reminding us of the incredible riches that are ours in Christ. It'll teach you who you are, how rich you are, how you're to use those riches for God's glory. Now, I want you to see that the book is based on this idea of riches and fullness and inheritance by showing you some verses throughout the book of Ephesians. For example, chapter 1, verse 7 talks about the riches of his grace at the end of the verse. Chapter 3, verse 8 talks about the unsearchable riches of Christ. Chapter 3, verse 16 talks about the riches of his glory. So think about it. You have the riches of his grace, the riches of his glory, and the riches of his son. In other words, what God is doing is he's unloading all of his riches through the book of Ephesians. In fact, the word grace is used 12 times. And the word grace is important because it means God's unmerited, undeserved kindness and favor. Grace is behind all of this lavishness that God has poured out. In fact, the word grace is used 12 times. The word glory is used 8 times. The word inheritance is used 4 times. The word riches is used 5 times. The word fullness and filled are used 7 times. And the key to everything is because we're in Christ, that all of the fullness of the riches of the inheritance of the glory of his grace is ours because we're in Christ, because we're one with Christ in his church, because we've been redeemed, that this incredible fullness, all of it is ours. In fact, maybe the sum of it all is found in chapter 3 where Paul writes this, that you might be filled with the fullness of God. And I think about how incredible that thought is, that literally the believer can be filled with the fullness of God himself, that we would know the unsearchable riches of Christ, that we would be able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we could ask or think according to the power of God that is at work in us. Now, I don't know about you, but I can ask and think about a lot. And what Paul is saying is this is going to exceed that abundantly above what you can ask, think, or imagine. All of this in Christ. So you see, there's these grand concepts that change everything. Fullness and riches and inheritance and wealth, resource, all of this found in the book of Ephesians. There's enough resources in heaven, what Paul is saying, to cover all of your past debts, sort of your present liabilities, and all of your future needs, and still not diminish your account. That's God's plan. In fact, in chapter 4, verse 13, Paul says this, that we would come to the knowledge of the stature of the Son of God, to the perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So think about it. You have in chapter 3, verse 19, the fullness of God. Chapter 4, verse 13, the fullness of Christ. Chapter 5, verse 18, he says to be filled with the Spirit, the fullness of the Spirit. He says the fullness of the Spirit, the fullness of Christ, the fullness of God, the full, glorious, gracious resource of God. Paul is saying it's all ours. So the guarantee for the believer in all of this is where it says that we find it in Christ. So think about this. As secure as Christ is in the plan of God and in the love of the Father, and as available as the resources of God are to Jesus, so available are they to you. Do you see? Because of our union in Christ, we become, according to Romans chapter 8, joint heirs. In fact, it says in the book of Hebrews that he, speaking of Jesus, is not ashamed to call us brother. And that he that is joined to the Spirit, or joined to the Lord rather, is one Spirit. We see that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. So what we have is what he has. What he has is what we have. We possess what he possesses. All of his riches are at our disposal. That's Ephesians. And all of this, it's all ours in Christ. It's all because we're in Christ. Now, if you're not in Christ, you're poor, you're destitute, you're a beggar. But if you are in Christ, you're rich beyond all wildest imagination. It's all based on him. It's not anything that we do. It's not anything that we earn. It's all his. In fact, for example, in Ephesians, all of our riches are based on these things. In fact, look at this. Based on His will, chapter 1, verse 5. His grace, chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. His glory, chapter 1, verse 12 and 14. His power, chapter 1, verse 19. His love, chapter 2, verse 4. His good pleasure, chapter 1, verse 9. His purpose, chapter 1, verse 11. His calling, chapter 1, verse 18. His inheritance, again, chapter 1, verse 18. And His workmanship, chapter 2, verse 10. It's all because of Him. It's all that we are in Christ. And thus, these things become ours. So this is our treasure. This is where we get to check out our resources. And in the first, now watch it. In the first three chapters, Paul tells us what they are. And in the last three chapters, he tells us how to use them. So you've got to get it all. You've got to stay with us for the entire series. You can't sort of spend them if you don't know what they are. And if you know what they are, you've got to know how to spend them. Now, let me take it a step further, and let's sort of turn the corner a little bit in the way that we think. Just kind of file that category of riches related to Ephesians, and I want to talk about another dimension, an important dimension. So Paul not only talks about our riches, but he talks about this whole idea that all of this is ours because we're in the church. Okay, it's all ours because we're in the church. No, not just that we're in Christ, but also because we're in the church. So the book then discusses the church. It discusses what the church is, how the church functions, how we function in the church, and it discusses the riches of the church. In fact, the key thought sort of relative to the church is found in a statement that Paul makes in the third chapter, and I'd like to look at it beginning in verse 3 and the following. He says this, in Ephesians chapter 3, Paul is talking about himself as an apostle, one who speaks the message of Christ, and he says this, here is the special message that I want to give you in this book of Ephesians. So verse 3. How that by revelation he's referring to Jesus Christ in verse 1, or God in verse 2, he made known to me the mystery. So Ephesians is all about a mystery. You could really call it sort of the mystery of the church. And so you ask, well, what is the mystery? We'll go down to verse 5. He says, which in other ages wasn't made known to the sons of men, as it is now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. So what Paul is saying is that it's a mystery that's been hidden. It's a mystery that's been around for a long time, but it's not a mystery anymore because it's now revealed. Look at verse 6. Here's what's been revealed through the mystery. That the Gentiles, that's you and me, should be fellow heirs of the same body. Now mark that term, sort of circle in your Bible that term body. It's the key to understanding Paul's definition of the church. He goes on. And partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. So maybe you're confused. Just try to stay with me. We're going to talk about this for a minute. But the book of Ephesians presents the mystery of the church. You say, well, what is it? Well, verse 3 says it's been revealed by revelation. He made known to me the mystery. So that's, it's been revealed to Paul. So you say, well, what is the mystery? Verse 5, something in other ages that wasn't made known, and it was now made known. So what is it? Well, that the Gentiles are now fellow heirs of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ by the gospel. In other words, the hidden secret of the past was now revealed to Paul. And what was it? It was that the Gentiles and the Jews would become one in one body in the church. So what is a mystery? Well, whenever you see the word mystery in the New Testament, you got to ask yourself, well, what is it? Well, it's not some kind of thing that you've got to sneak around and find the answer to. No, a mystery simply means something that had been hidden in the past, specifically in the Old Testament times, and it's now revealed in the New Testament. And what was this mystery? That the church would come into existence and that it would be one body, uniting Jew and Gentile into one living organism. That's something the Old Testament saints, they never saw this. They would have never believed this. They never saw it coming. It's a mystery to them, which is now revealed through Paul. So these are the mysteries. So when you see the word mystery in chapter 3, verse 3, it simply means a spiritual truth never before revealed, but now revealed in the New Testament. So think of it this way. It's new truth for a new age. Now, here's why this is important, family. You got to hang on to this. You got to get this. Listen, we know things that people in the history of God's dealing with man up to the New Testament never knew. Think of, we have spiritual truth, spiritual resources that those in the Old Testament never had. In other words, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven were secrets from the foundation of the world up until the New Testament era when Jesus opened his mouth and he taught them. So think about this. I want you to understand how important this is. Family, you know things that people in the Old Testament, no matter how devout, no matter how devoted they were, no matter how godly they were, no matter how convinced of it they were, we know things that they never knew. I mean, think about what a spiritual resource this is, what a treasure house of divine reality it is, because we're in Christ and we're in his church and living in this sort of incredible age where God's revelation is full and complete. So think of it this way. We're living in sort of the sacred secret. We're living in an age that the Old Testament people never saw, the mystery form of the kingdom. And the key to this mystery is that the incredible truth that God would take Jew and Gentile and make them one body. One body. That's the great secret, that we are one body in Jesus Christ. But the key truth that I want you to get in the book of Ephesians is that the church is presented as a body. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 6, a body. So he uses this as a metaphor. So you ask, well, what's a metaphor? Well, a metaphor is a way of saying something that gives you a better understanding of it. Now, this metaphor here that Paul uses is of a body. The church is like a body, that it's sort of this interlinking organism. The church is not an organization. It's not something that you join. It's not a building. It's an organism, that we are all one in Christ. And through us pulses the powerful blood of Jesus, as it were, the life of God, that we're one and we are inextricably united. And if one believer in the body doesn't do what he's supposed to do, then what happens is the body breaks down and the body malfunctions at that place. And when it malfunctions, what that means is that somebody else has to pick up the slack. And so when somebody else has to pick up the slack, the body begins to limp along. That's why the world thinks that Christ is a cripple. See, the body must be whole and complete. That's why in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul says, till we all come to the full measure or the full stature of Christ, that Christ should stand up in full functioning form in his body. The church, just as he did in his human body in his incarnation. Think about it this way. I like to call the church body two. Body one was Jesus incarnate, taking on flesh. Body two is Christ taking on flesh through his church. And we should be just as whole and just as full as he was when he came in one body. So the church is a body. Now, throughout scripture, there's other metaphors that are used. The church is called a lot of different things in the New Testament, and all of those things have parallels in the Old Testament. But here's what's crazy. Body isn't one of them. For example, in the Old Testament, God called his people a bride. You remember the prophet Hosea? Hosea took a bride. Her name was Gomer. She turned out to be a prostitute. I guess it's probably safe to say that anybody who marries a girl named Gomer's probably bound to run into some sort of problems at some point. But she turns out to be a prostitute. And God said this: this is what happened to me. I, God, have chosen you, Israel, and you have prostituted yourself to false gods. So in the Old Testament, Israel was a bride, betrothed to God, entering into a marriage covenant with God. And in the Old Testament, another metaphor that was used was that of a vine. God says in Isaiah chapter 5, I planted Israel a vine in a very fertile hill, and I waited for Israel to bring forth grapes, and she brought forth wild grapes. So God saw Israel as a vine. He saw Israel also as a flock. He led Joseph like a flock, Isaiah 40. He lifted them up and carried them. He gathered the lambs in his arms and gently led those that were with young. He saw Israel as a flock. In fact, in Psalm 23, they said that the Lord is my shepherd. So this idea of flock is there. The idea of vine and flock and the bride, that's Old Testament. But you know something? It's New Testament too. And the New Testament is not the church seen as the bride of Christ, Ephesians chapter 5. Are not we seen as the vine and the branches in John chapter 15? Are we not seen as the flock in John chapter 10, where Jesus says that he is the good shepherd? I know my sheep, they hear my voice and they follow me. And there are other metaphors used. For example, God's people are a kingdom in the Old Testament. They're a kingdom in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, God saw Israel as a family and they were called to him as father. In the New Testament, we are the household of God, Ephesians chapter 2, it says. And in the New Testament, we are called a building, a spiritual temple. That's also an Old Testament concept as well. So the metaphors of Israel and the church are sort of synonymous until you get to one metaphor, And that's the metaphor of the body. There's no Old Testament use of that metaphor. So this is unique, it's mysterious, it's unrevealed, brand new, new truth for a new age, that we are a body in which God can reincarnate himself in Christ and manifest himself. And family, that's why we all have to be functioning as one. And the body sort of functions as one through spiritual gifts and through responsibilities of fellowship and shared ministry. And when that happens, then Christ comes to the full stature in his church. And the reason the world has a hard time believing us is because of the unbelievable confusion of the church that puts forth a Christ that's not very clear. But what Ephesians is reminding us, and what we're being reminded of today, and what God is reminding us through his Spirit, is that we are a body. So unity is key. One body. And so I want to ask you, family, how are we doing at unity? Are we getting along in the things that really matter? Or are we getting caught up in division and the things that don't matter? See, Jesus came to break down the dividing walls of division. He's come to bring unity between both Gentile and Jew. He's come to bring unity between people who once were far away from God and far away from one another. Because in a body, you see unity in a way that you can't see it anywhere else. A single body, and yet in this body, amazing diversity and mutual dependence upon one another, and dependence upon God. So the human body is a perfect illustration of how the church is to function. And so when we learn these truths and we stop being a group of people just sort of sitting in our own little sanctified seat, watching it all happen, and we actually start functioning like the body, we start coordinating and ministering together and loving and sharing, then we begin to move. And then we begin to understand in Christ and in the church the riches that are ours, the resources that are ours in Jesus Christ. Now, the way that Paul pins this letter, the first three chapters of Ephesians sort of gives us the theology of the body. And the last three gives the behavior of the body. So the first three chapters is doctrine, and the last three chapters is sort of how we do it, the practice. And so you're going to see how this marvelous body in Christ functions, how rich it is, and how you take those riches and those resources and you use them for God's glory. By the way, the foundation of all of this is grace. Grace is the foundation of all of these blessings. It's out of his grace that all of this comes. In fact, Paul's message throughout the book of Ephesians is this, that you might understand God's grace, that you might possess his peace because you are a part of his church and you have at your disposal his infinite riches. And so this is going to be a great study. And I hope that you get your heart and your mind ready for what it is that God has to say. This is going to be a great opportunity, Bear Creek, for us to be united, no longer divided, but united around the things of God in Christ and in the church as we learn how to live out and spend the glorious inheritance and riches that God has given us. And we're going to experience that through the book of Ephesians. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this beautiful book that you've given us to remind us whose we are and what we belong to. That we are yours, Jesus, and we belong to you, but we also belong to one another. That though we are in Christ, we are also in the church. And so, Jesus, I just pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, you would continue to convict and to convince us of that truth. That you would unpack and unfold through this book and through our lives and through our actions, Lord. All of the riches and the glory of your full measure, that we would grow up into the full measure of who you are, Jesus. That the world would no longer see in Bear Creek and in your body, Lord, confusion and a crippled Christ, but that we would see, they would see unity and they would see love and they would see the power of Christ at work in a lost and broken world. And so, Father, we thank you for the riches that are ours in Christ and in the church. And we pray that you would be glorified in all that we say and do. And so, Jesus, would you bless us and keep us? Would you continue to make your face to shine upon us? Would you raise your countenance upon us, Lord, and be gracious to us all the days of our lives? Jesus, we need you and we love you. And it's in your beautiful name, Jesus, that we find all of these riches and that we pray these things. Amen. Bear Creek, we love you and we long to be with you. And until we see you again next week, may the Lord bless and keep you. And remember these three words: you are loved.